All right, this is me. Good morning, Eliza. Can you all hear me? Yes, great. I don't want to break any china in Carrie Mae's house this morning. So, like this says, and Carl welcomed me, I'm here to talk about this thing called the Black Artist Retreat. We call it B.A.R. for short. And last year, Theaster Gates and myself sent out a beautiful, embossed, somewhat cryptic invitation that read, "Please join us in Chicago for the inaugural Black Artists Retreat." Along with a bit of event information, there was an email address listed to which one could RSVP, send comments or questions. I was hopeful. I began to receive emails and opened each eagerly. One of the first email responses read, "Really? Black artists have been in retreat for 40 years. Surely the respondent was right. It may have been hyperbolic to say the first inaugural. I responded, "First inaugural. We hope you can join us." As for the skeptic, we never saw him. However, there were many more enthusiastic respondents who decided to show up and participate. Though they may not have been entirely sure of what they were attending or what was going to take place, their presence affirmed a desire and need to come together in this moment. All said and done, we welcomed about 100 artists and creatives for 2 days in August. The programming was anchored around the reading of a historical text, The Black Artist in America, a symposium, which originally appeared in the Metropolitan Museum of Art Bulletin in January 1969. The conversation took place on the occasion of Harlem on My Mind exhibition at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. 7 gentlemen artists, varying in age and career stage, came together to discuss this black artist: Sam Gilliam, Richard Hunt, Jacob Lawrence, Tom Lloyd, William Williams, and Hale Woodruff spoke with Romare Bearden as the moderator. For those who may not be familiar with the Harlem on My Mind exhibition, it was intended to explore the cultural life of the predominantly black enclave of Harlem. As it turns out, the Metropolitan chose not to allow any actual artists from Harlem to participate in the exhibition. The exclusion only furthered a rift between white and black artists culturally and aesthetically, a binary which was surely felt throughout other arenas in America at the close of the civil rights era as well. The exclusion mobilized activism in the black artist community, pushing artists to advocate for the inclusion of black artists in mainstream museums and galleries. It also created an impetus for artists and creative workers to take it upon themselves to organize their own exhibitions and forums. Once we all came together in August, we're sitting in a room together and listening to this conversation, we had to and began to ask ourselves, how could it be that a dialogue, 45 years old, sounded as though it could have happened yesterday? Had anything changed in the interim? What is this term, black artist? Who is this black artist? Is it self-assigned or assigned to us? When should we embrace it and when should we resist it? These questions, their continuation for the last decades, and the necessary constant re-examination of these questions are the driving force of the Black Artist Retreat convening. So, cue the video, please.
Into the light.
Lead us forever in the path, we pray.
Amen.
The real job still remains in the hands of the art institutions, galleries, and museums to provide the black artist with that kind of professional and prestigious support he needs for his continued development.
I think one thing we can do is just what we're doing now.
The question is, you're a black artist. What are you doing? What do you want to do? Where do you want to go? Instead of saying, you are in it, you're an artist who has been suppressed.
I think there needs to be a gigantic effort to bring art to young black kids in an enormous project.
I mean, we do have to begin to make the black community more aware, more visually oriented.
If there is a separate black art, it might be a good thing, because what's been going on before has not been a good thing.
How would this black art be different from white art? The question I'm really posing is, how does one make art relevant to its community? What makes it black art then, beyond that you did it?
I don't know what makes it black art, except that it exists in the black community.
I think you needlessly confuse the issues by insisting that there's something about living in a black community that makes your art black. That's just not true.
Many of the things we're talking about not only pertain to the Negro artist, but pertain to the artist generally.
What we should be talking about is the quality of aesthetic experiences available to the persons within the black community and raising the level of this quality.
What kind of facilities are open to us? What galleries will accept us?
Let's talk about moving into business. Art is a business.
We're getting involved in sociology again, aren't we?
Well, so what?
And I do think there should be a communal feeling among the black artists. Whether or not we paint or think alike, or whether we sit down and beef like we're doing today.
We know that a lot of things came out of this conversation in 68-69, and my hope is that from this conversation, lots of things will spill out. We won't be able to do it all today, but I just want to acknowledge that.
Why are we sitting in this room, and what is the relevance of this text to us contemporarily? What does this actually mean to us now, and how has the critical landscape been shifted and changed?
I knew Tom Lord very well. Some people started to destroy the work, and they were saying, this is not black art. It was a deeply traumatizing moment for Tom.
And of all the people, I actually think Kerry James Marshall is the heir, because he's the one on panels always saying, I don't mind being called a black artist. I want to be called a black artist.
We have to support people like myself. People like myself have to support people who are in this room.
My ambition was that we could take a moment and be black, unapologetically, and then we could go back into the world and be like, you know what, I'm an American, I'm a historian, I'm not a black historian. You can say whatever the hell you want. But in this place, you have the freedom and the safety to actually deal with the topic that some of us rarely get to actually talk really candidly about.
I see this event as an advance. And I really like the idea of looking at this as a forward-moving piece.
So I just wanted to say that I think we can all reach out to somebody that we know who is already interested in the arts.
One thing that I think is really so fertile about being here is that we have the ability to discuss with one another about their process. And it's really important to go beyond the idea of this sort of lone artist.
We've come together for the first time. Hopefully we will see each other again, and maybe we will see some of you in an organized way. Maybe we won't, but hopefully we will.
So one of our initial goals was to create the time and space for intergenerational dialogue instigated by artists for artists outside of the institution that reflects and considers how contemporary artists of color engage the art world and one another. With the reenactment as the central piece, the rest of the programming retained a balance of structured moments and openness, which left room for a kind of intimacy and organic exchange, as the retreat intends to support fellowship instead of networking. After the first retreat, Theaster, Carrie May, our lovely host, Sarah Workna, and myself came together to share our reflections of the first retreat and what thoughts others had shared with us. We agreed that the energy was undeniable, but our potential had not been reached. Over the course of 8 months, we decided that the ambition of B.A.R. right now was to allow it and the people who comprise it to remain in the loftier world of ideas. We were not in a rush to necessarily realize an exhibition, simply to say, we now have done this, but to mimic a think tank, to allow ourselves to generate ideas and actually give ourselves time and space to examine the questions that are so critical to the Black artists working today. In order to allow the community to determine what the community itself felt was important, we imagined an open proposal system guided by four categories: research, advocacy, criticism, and exhibition. Luckily for a bunch of Black artists, it resulted in the acronym RACE. The prompt was simple: what are the issues we now face? What are the themes, concepts, and ideas that underscore critical thought and artist production? Proposals were held to 500 words with no promises to actually materialize anything proposed. Now, having just finished 2 days of proposal deliberations with 15 wonderful readers, we have collectively shaped and chosen which proposals to shepherd towards the second iteration of the Black Artist Retreat in Chicago. The task of the readers was a big one, as they at once they had to assess the proposals received based on their content, as well as the possibilities of the form that any one proposal would take, and whether that would be the most dynamic and effective for the larger group of attendees. We received some wonderful proposals with overlaps where we may not have ever imagined them. It was exciting to read them, and this facet of BAR will allow us to connect makers who may not have ever known they shared an interest with one another. This process and modeling of a space of exchange and opening pathways is part of the joy of the Black Artist Retreat. The work of the readers was also to assess the overall framework that we are asking these questions within. One proposal in particular articulated and reiterated the questions and concerns we must collectively ask ourselves and one another when we convene. Misa Dason was an artist and anthropologist that I don't think any of us at the Black Artist Retreat were aware of. She sent in a proposal. She may actually be here today, but I'm gonna read a section of her proposal. So it's titled Inside Out, Outside In, Black Cultural Producers, Privilege and Margins. Black artists and cultural producers in the 21st century find ourselves in a unique and paradoxical situation. We inhabit a privileged position in society while continuing to face systemic marginalization and racism in our elite spaces. While we recognize and experience While we recognize and experience continued practices of marginalization in the art world, we as privileged cultural producers are simultaneously aware of participating in the structural marginalization of others. One, now that we have gained greater access to the institutions that exhibit and support our work, now that we have gained greater representation and greater representation of plural Black identities, is representation enough? How are Black cultural producers using our privileged positions to address the continuing material inequity of the larger communities we come from? Two, what are we doing with the gains in privilege and power to open greater access and opportunities for those who will come after us? How are we addressing the increasing material obstacles newer generations of cultural producers face in efforts to gain access to the very institutions that we work in and with? The last few years bear witness to an increase in articles written about political and social organizing held in an effort to expose exploitative labor practices in the art world amid a crushing economic recession. How are Black cultural producers creating and engaging accessible, sustainable, and equitable labor practices in our work? Finally, the never-ending question of who and what are we referring to when we say Black artists? The question calls us to engage deeper with the concept of Blackness as a political identity rather than solely as a diasporic cultural identity. It explores what productive channels of theory and practice are closed off to us when we fail to investigate the rhetoric which grounds our perceived solidarity as Black cultural producers, but is not always based on material and historical truths. So Misa will be a part of our retreat, among others, this August. And Misa's three questions on representation, access, and identity articulate a sense of the field on which we are playing. I'm excited for her to develop this proposal with the readers, myself, Carrie May, Theaster, and Sarah, and most importantly, bring the work to the attendees of the treat. the retreat. We must continue to imagine solidarity between Black, Brown, and Beige brothers and sisters for ourselves in the face of institutional and mainstream exclusion. We must also question the models and structures that allow one to rise at the expense of another. I look forward to seeing some of you in August, and to the rest, reporting back.